Henry Louis Vivian D'Orozio lived a short yet an eventful life. He was a poet, a teacher, a reformer, or should I say, a radical thinker. D'Orozio was born in Calcutta in the year 1809, exactly 20 years after the French Revolution. He was a very gifted student of the school set up by David Drummond, which was at Dharamtala. This institution was known as Drummond's Academy or Dharamtala Academy School. He studied in this institution from the age 6 till he was 14. And his first job at a very young age was with James Scott and Co., the same place where his father was a chief accountant. D'Orozio left Scott and Co. after 2 years, and then he moved to Bagalpur to work in an indigo factory. He then returned to Calcutta, and in the year 1826, he became the sub-editor at India Gazette. India Gazette was an English newspaper, a weekly English newspaper. It was also the second newspaper printed in India. Later that same year, in November 1826, he joined the Hindu College as a teacher. And we will spend a lot of time understanding his life, his stay at the Hindu College. One thing is clear, that D'Orozio was a self-taught person. We need to understand something very important. D'Orozio was by no means well connected in Calcutta. He was born in a house located east of Lower Circular Road. Why is this important? Because this Lower Circular Road was clearly not part of the White Town. And it was this White Town where the elite of Calcutta lived. D'Orozio was of Anglo-Portuguese descent. The D'Orozio family was seen as East Indians. And therefore, as somewhat inferior to the white population. Sometime in the year 1816, Raja Ram Mohan Roy called a meeting of his friends. Why? He wanted to discuss ways in which they could undermine idol worship. David Hare, who was a friend of Raja Ram Mohan Roy, he also attended this meeting, although he was not invited to this meeting. David Hare had come to Calcutta from Scotland. The year was 1800, at the age of 25, and had begun trade as a watchmaker. This is something we have discussed in the Raja Ram Mohan Roy video lecture as well. If you haven't watched that lecture yet, please do now. David Hare was also a philanthropist. At this meeting, David Hare argued that one of the ways in which idolatry could be eradicated was by establishing an English school. There was a general agreement, but no one acted upon it. David Hare believed that there is a lot of scope for an English school in Calcutta. In early 19th century Calcutta, if you had knowledge of English, you were treated as someone very, very special. In fact, there were two boys. You don't need to remember their names, but there were two boys, one Nithai and the other Advait Sen. They went to a school in central Calcutta. They could speak only superficial English, yet they were held in awe in their locality. Now, it was agreed that there should be a college, and the primary objective of this college or institution is to teach the sons of respectable Hindus in English, in Indian language, and where the literature, where the science shall also be taught. As the name of the institution made evident, this was emphatically a Hindu college. It was conceived by Hindus, for Hindus, and it was financed by Hindus as well. Yes, there were Europeans such as Hyde East, Europeans such as David Hare and others. They also played the role of facilitators. David Hare, despite being European, he was identified with the Hindus of Calcutta. Their rejoicing was his rejoicing. Their sorrow was his sorrow. So now there was an agreement that there shall be an English school for the Hindu boys. But then came a challenge, a difficulty. Some people said that Raja Ram Mohan Roy would also be part of this initiative. This angered the Orthodox Hindus. And they said, if Raja Ram Mohan Roy is going to be part of this college, we have got nothing to do with such a college and we won't send our boys, our sons, to such a school. David Hare now spoke with Raja Ram Mohan Roy and persuaded him. And Raja Ram Mohan Roy agreed not to have anything to do with the college. The college opened. The year was 1817. In January 1817, the college opened. D'Orozio joined this essentially Hindu institution as the fourth teacher. The year was 1826. He was only 17 at the time, just a little older than his students, and had no teaching experience whatsoever. How and why he got the job cannot be explained. Why? Not enough literature is available on this subject, on this matter. But historians have speculated. What? By the year 1825 to 1826, Hindu College was in a financial mess. The college had only ₹65,000 remaining. D'Orozio joined Hindu College precisely at this juncture. Logic could be, if we hire a British teacher, we need to pay him more. Let's hire an East Indian instead on a lesser salary. That's how D'Orozio got the job. When D'Orozio joined the college, he immediately became quite popular amongst the students. And it is this popularity which also led to his exit from the college. Till now, we have looked at the recruitment of D'Orozio to the Hindu college. Now, let's look at the life of D'Orozio at the college and then his exit as well. First, D'Orozio emphasized that students should think for themselves. This was what D'Orozio said is the sacred duty of the students. That was first lesson that he taught the students. Think for themselves. Second, there should be a free exchange of ideas. And everyone should clearly express what they felt. This was point two. Third, he encouraged students to read books that they would not have read as part of the curriculum. Go beyond your syllabus is what D'Orozio would often tell his students. Point number four, he impressed upon his students the importance of virtue, the importance of truth. And finally, he encouraged students to meet him outside the classroom, outside the college, and to speak frankly to him. His age, no doubt, helped in such interactions. He was very young. What D'Orozio was attempting to do was nothing more and nothing less than what good teachers do, which is to encourage reading and critical thinking, to open the minds of their students. Good teachers always encourage students to question them, debate. He presented his hopes and aims as a teacher in a sonnet that he wrote in the year 1829, while he was still teaching at the Hindu college. He wrote, "Expanding like the petals of young flowers, I watch the gentle opening of your minds and the sweet loosening of the spell that binds your intellectual energies and powers that stretch their wings to try their strength." The impact of D'Orozio's teaching was not unexpected, as students began to think for themselves and experience what D'Orozio called the loosening of the spell. They began to look critically at the world around them. They started questioning the rituals, the customs, the caste rules. Some of them started drinking. Some started eating non-vegetarian food. Some students started eating together with the Christian and Muslim boys. Remember, the founders of the college did not want Raja Ram Mohan Roy to be associated with the college. Now, the irony is that they are witnessing an even more radical figure, D'Orozio. Naturally, the parents of these boys became worried. And one of the first to officially voice this alarm was Raja Radhakanta Deb. Raja Radhakanta Deb had been associated with the college since its inception. He was a philanthropist, but at the same time was a die-hard conservative. He wrote to H.H. Wilson. H.H. Wilson was an important member of the managing committee of the college. He wrote that boys of the college have violated caste rules, eating and drinking forbidden things with Christians and Muslims. He proposed that these offending students should be expelled from the college, and teachers by whom they had been corrupted, by whom they had been misled, they should also be expelled. But in this letter, he did not name D'Orozio, and he wrote teachers, plural, instead of just a teacher. In fact, before this letter, there was a meeting of the college where a proposal was made to admit Christian and Muslim boys as well. But the managing committee rejected this proposal. Radhakanta Deb, in his letter to H.H. Wilson, he is mentioning this point. And he's saying that, look, Hindu college was meant exclusively for Hindus. Students of other religious communities were not to be admitted. English education is okay, but we cannot denigrate our religion. We cannot violate its rules and rules of our caste. But D'Orozio, he continued his teaching. He continued to make an impact. And some of the parents either stopped sending their sons or withdrew them from the school. This so alarmed the Hindu managers of the college that Ram Kamal Sen was also an important member of the managing committee. He was also one of the founders of this college. Ram Kamal Sen, he proposed that there should be a meeting. A meeting should be called of the entire managing committee. When the meeting was called, Mr. Sen urged the college that the college will not prosper till D'Orozio was removed. D'Orozio was described as being the root of all evil. The gloves were finally off. Mr. Sen further proposed that those students who are known to be eating Western food and those who are hostile to Hinduism should be expelled. Those students attending private lectures and meetings should be removed, and teachers should be stopped from eating at the school table. At this meeting, both H.H. Wilson and David Hare, they tried to argue that let's not remove D'Orozio, since both of them judged D'Orozio to be a very competent teacher. But in the end, both declined to vote, since this subject was affecting only the feelings of the native Indians. The majority voted in favor of D'Orozio's dismissal. Being informed of this decision, D'Orozio sent his resignation on 25th April 1831. After his resignation, D'Orozio wrote a separate letter to H.H. Wilson. He writes that first, no charge was brought against me. Second, if any accusation was brought forward, I was not informed of it. Third, I was not called up to face my accusers. Fourth, no witness was examined on either side. Fifth, D'Orozio writes that my conduct, my character has come under scrutiny. Yet no opportunity was given to me to defend myself. D'Orozio writes that at least you should have conducted an inquiry. At least there should have been mockery of a trial. Nevertheless, D'Orozio left Hindu College. He died of cholera at the end of the same year, 1831. Which reminds me of one more incident. When D'Orozio was teaching at the Hindu College, it was a practice in the college for every teacher to submit a monthly progress report to the headmaster. D'Orozio was often a defaulter in this. He would sometimes submit, sometimes he did not. On one occasion, when he took his report to the headmaster, David Hare was also present there. The headmaster lifted his hand in anger to strike D'Orozio, who avoided it by backing away. Not just this, D'Orozio was very talented, and this talent allowed him to come in contact with some of the well-known names of the early 19th century Calcutta. He knew John Grant, who was the editor of India Gazette newspaper. He also knew H.M. Parker. H.M. Parker was the secretary to the Board of Customs. Obviously, he knew H.H. Wilson, he knew David Hare. D'Orozio was also a friend of Emma Roberts, who is considered to be the first woman poet of British India. But no one protested when D'Orozio was sacked from the college. Yes, he resigned, but this resignation was not voluntary. He was in effect sacked from the college. No one protested, or at least there is no record of any kind of protest. And to tell you, no European could have been dismissed like this without any inquiry, which clearly means that East Indians were considered racially inferior. D'Orozio's poetry, which forms the bulk of what he wrote, has been expertly analyzed by Professor Rosinka Chaudhary. His poetry has been analyzed by Professor Rosinka Chaudhary. According to her, D'Orozio's poetry was imbued with national aspiration, endeavor, inspired as it was by the romantics, especially of Shelley. In his poetry, D'Orozio addressed India, not just Bengal. Professor Chaudhary describes him as a self-consciously nationalist poet of India. Now we come across the Young Bengals, or D'Orozians. The Young Bengal was a group of Bengali free thinkers emerging from the Hindu college. They were also known as D'Orozians. These D'Orozians attacked the superstitions, useless customs and rituals, basically revolted against the then social and religious structure. The Young Bengal movement was like a mighty storm that tried to sweep away everything before it. It was a storm that lashed society with violence, causing some good, but perhaps naturally as well, some discomfort and distress. These D'Orozians, however, they failed to have a long-term impact. And the main reason for their limited success was social conditions prevailing at that time, which we can say were not ripe for adoption of such radical ideas. Further, theirs was not a mass movement. Peasants were not involved. So basically, this Young Bengal movement failed to extend their influence to the masses, to the peasants. But some of the ideas of Vivian D'Orozio, they find mention in our constitution. Article 19.1a talks about freedom of speech and expression. This is what D'Orozio taught his students: to think rationally, to think critically, to express yourself freely. Article 25 of the Constitution, which talks about freedom of conscience. This is also the idea of D'Orozio. In fact, Fundamental Duties chapter, mentioned under Part 4, Capital A of the Constitution, under Article 51, Capital A, it talks about a list of fundamental duties that should be followed by every single citizen of this country. One such fundamental duty talks about, it urges the citizens to develop scientific temper, humanism, spirit of reform. These are the ideas that find mention in Indian Constitution as well. In recognition of D'Orozio's impact on India's social, educational and cultural sphere, a commemorative postage stamp of D'Orozio was issued by the Government of India in December 2009, recognizing the impact and the efforts and the contribution of Henry Vivian D'Orozio. D'Orozio died of cholera in December 1831. The same year, he was forced to resign from the Hindu college. The college and its students, it could be said, were his life. For more videos, download Byju's, the exam prep app.